Ladies and gentlemen, my name is Subrata Mitra. I'm Director, ISAS. On behalf of the ISAS community, it gives me very great pleasure to welcome Ambassador Jayant Prasad, Director General of the Institute for Defense Studies and Analysis, Delhi, of India, from Delhi, to talk to us on the future of Afghanistan, prospects for peace and reconciliation. Ambassador Prasad was ambassador of India to Afghanistan, Algeria, Nepal, and the United Conference on Disarmament, Geneva. At headquarters in the Ministry of External Affairs of India, he served as Special Secretary, Public Diplomacy, and Head of the Americas and the Multilateral Economic Relations Divisions. He was the rapporteur of the United Nations Commission on Human Rights, Geneva, from 86 to 87, and was a fellow at the Weatherhead Center for International Affairs, Harvard University, in 1998-99. He was also a member of the United Nations Secretary General's Advisory Board on Disarmament Matters, 2005 to 2007, and visiting scholar, Center for the Advanced Study of India, University of Pennsylvania, 2014-15. Before his 37-year stint in public service, he was a lecturer in history, St. Stephen's College, University of Delhi. That's my time. I was in the wrong college. I was in Kurdimal. Just opposite, but a different world altogether.
Yes.
After completing his studies at the Modern School, again a very famous public school, of Delhi, he went to St. Stephen's College and Jawaharlal Nehru University, much in the news these days. That was also my university. I am delighted to let you know that we were recently in Delhi as a part of the Delhi Dialogue, which ISAS organizes, and we used the opportunity to sign a memorandum of understanding with Jayantji, and we have had a long conversation today. You would see many more joint activities of ISAS and the IDSA. This lecture actually gets those activities started. His Excellency is in Singapore, not just for us, but actually for the Indo-China Dialogue, which is organized by the LKY School. And I invited him to take an extra day to spend with us, and he has graciously agreed. I'm very, very grateful to you. I would like you to share experiences with him, because he'll talk for about 30 minutes, but we'll have plenty of time for a proper interaction for his time in Afghanistan, because we have old Afghan hands like our editor Surya Narayan here, and His Excellency Iftikhar Chaudhary, has known, who has been everywhere and has done everything, would happily also join in. I look forward to the talk, and the talk after the talk, that will be your time. Johnson, we have saved a... He's not here yet. Okay, good. Excellency, you have the floor.
Thank you. Professor Mitra, this introduction has been far too generous. I'm very honored to be here and to have this opportunity to interact with your diverse group of core membership of ISAS and some guests who have come from outside. It's good to also connect with friends with whom I have had contact in the past, but we have been in itinerant contact, not regular contact. Iftikhar Bhai is one of them. And to renew my acquaintance with Mr. Surya Narayana, good to see you here, and to make new friends. Afghanistan seemed to have been on the mend some 4 years after the American intervention there, which led to the fall of the Taliban regime within weeks of the American bombing that started in retribution to 9/11. And what unfolded afterwards was a little tragic. The high point was the London conference of December 2005, January 2006, when it seemed that Afghanistan was on the verge of becoming like a mirror image of a Western democracy, women's rights, and functioning public institutions. But Afghanistan had been subverted long before that. The early promise of a new Afghanistan disappeared pretty much by the end of 2003. What happened was that after the intervention, the early international presence there unfortunately argued for a light footprint. That included Vendrell, that included Brahimi, who were the representatives of the Secretary General. The kind of commitments that were required in terms of finances was modest, but even those modest funds were not available. And the American forces were minimal, and those minimal forces were further diminished in 2003 when attention turned to Iraq. And you know the consequences for West Asia of what happened in Iraq. And then you see what happened, as if the lessons learned from Iraq were not enough. 8 years later, the unraveling of Libya, and then the intervention in Syria, the great irresponsibility of, I would say, lack of attention from the top, from the United States, because the same United States reacted differently in 1956 when the British and the French tried to intervene in Egypt after the nationalization of the Suez Canal Company. But here you have President Obama in his interview to the Atlantic Journal. Many of you would have read it already. It appeared 10 days ago. bemoaning the fact that contrary to his own temperament and inclination and U.S. interests, he got entangled in a European project in what we call West Asia and what the West calls the Middle East, which has led to a more unsettled West Asia than at any time since the disintegration of the Ottoman Empire. Back to Afghanistan. So what happened then was that even when the American intervention was in its early weeks, in the first week of December, there was a 4 or 5 day airlift from Kunduz, where the forces that were collected of the Taliban and the Al-Qaeda trying to take over the remnant of Afghanistan, a small sliver of territory in Takhar and Panjshir from Ahmad Shah Massoud, they were all bunched up there, they were cornered, and they were flown out to Pakistan. Pakistan told the United States then that this was just a handful of people, that they would take care of them, and we are still paying for the consequences of that early neglect by the international community, both by way of what had to be done on the ground militarily and what needed to be done in building up Afghanistan's national strength in the years afterwards. And by 2005, by the time the London conference was resolving to do various things to transform Afghanistan, it was already too late. And to give you a very stark example, I reached Afghanistan in January 2008. 2006, the British decided there was divided responsibility. So the manner in which the international community operated in Afghanistan was not at all operating in a national territory. For instance, the Germans took charge of Kunduz and Mazar-e-Sharif and that northern area. The Italians and the Spaniards took charge of Herat. The Canadians took charge of Kandahar. And the British took charge of one cross-cutting issue, which is counter-narcotics. The Germans took charge of another cross-cutting issue, which was police training. And the Americans took charge of military training and so on. And the British also took charge of one of the 34 provinces of Afghanistan, which is the province of Helmand. And so this decision was taken in the beginning of 2006. The rest of 2006, the British spent in deploying 8,000 troops in the province of Helmand. So they struck a deal with the Taliban that they wouldn't fire upon each other unless it was a retaliatory firing. And this was based on an understanding that was reached in Musa Kala. And it was supposedly reached between the Taliban and the local population. But what happened as a consequence of that deployment of force by the British and the expulsion of one person who had kept the peace there, the governor of the province called Akhundzada, who was a close associate of President Karzai. Three of the districts had some Taliban presence in the beginning of 2006, out of 11. Eight were completely in the hands of government. And at the end of the British deployment, eight of the districts went into the hands of the Taliban, except the district headquarters, and three remained with the government. And what happened to counter-narcotics in 2007, the year after the British were deployed in Helmand? Afghanistan produced 8,000 metric tons of opium, the highest ever production till then, which has only recently been surpassed. And out of that, 60% of the production was in Helmand province, which meant that Helmand produced more than half of the global production of opium and heroin. So this is just an illustration. I mean, the other illustration was I went around calling on people just to give you a picture of how Afghanistan was in 2008. Many things have positively changed, but many things have remained the same. Talk about police reforms. So when I went to call on the US ambassador, there was Ambassador Wood in station at that time. He was my homologue. So he said that I should visit the police headquarters, and irrespective of where the commissioner would take me, I should just barge into the first room on the left as I entered the main building. And he wouldn't tell me more. So I did what I was told. I went into the police headquarters with the police top brass, and unmindful of my escorts, I opened the room. And then I had difficulty in understanding where I had reached, because there were miniature tables and chairs. And only when I lifted my sight, I saw along the walls some dolls and stuffed toys. And I realized that that was a creche. And it was a creche meant for women policemen. The idea was good. But what I'm suggesting here is that the Germans were trying to train the Afghan police in the mirror image of what they would do in Germany, not what was required to be done in Afghanistan. So there are many, many multiple examples of this type. So I don't want to dwell on vignettes. I want to quickly take you, because of the paucity of time, in what is the existential situation in Afghanistan today. And for that, I'll turn to the report. Every 3 months, the Secretary General, his representative, the SRSG in Kabul, is supposed to go to New York and brief the Security Council. So Haysom has just briefed the Security Council yesterday or the day before. And he spoke on five issues. Just for the sake of convenience, you can begin anywhere and end anywhere, but I'll just dwell on these five clusters that he addressed in his briefing. But I'm not talking about the type of briefing that he tendered, but taking a cue from that, just by way of caption. So first he talked about the fragile nature of the Afghan economy today, that Afghanistan was growing at a pace of, on a very low base, it had been growing at 10% plus for several years, and then dramatically that declined in 2014 and 15, and this year it's expected to be around 1% or just over. That itself is a surprise, because I would have thought Afghanistan's growth would go into negative territory. But other signs about the economy are quite ominous. There is a flight not only of capital from Afghanistan, but also of talent and of youth. And of the 1 million plus refugees that have found their way to different West European countries, 213,000 of them are young Afghans. There are whole sectors which have collapsed. The transportation sector has collapsed, the construction sector has collapsed, and these have collapsed simply because much of the activity related to construction and movement of goods was because of the huge foreign presence in Afghanistan, which has dwindled to just 20,000 or so military personnel. Now, what about the resurgence of Taliban? Afghanistan has 34 provinces and 286 districts. None of the district headquarters had fallen to the Taliban while the Western forces were there in full strength, which was till the middle of 2014. Now, many district headquarters are actually in the hands of the Taliban, but we don't talk about it because it's politically incorrect to talk about it. But Kunduz, the district headquarters, fell into Taliban hands briefly for a few weeks and was retaken. The situation is that even at the height of the Western military presence in Afghanistan, the more Western forces increased, the more Taliban became ubiquitous in the country. And President Obama, I don't know what came to him and who advised him, that the day he announced the surge of US troops in Afghanistan, he also declared a timetable for their exit. He called it the US exit strategy. And whether or not you agree with Henry Kissinger on other issues that he has been writing about, I agreed with him entirely when he promptly wrote an op-ed at that time and said that this exit strategy was all about exit and not at all about strategy, because you couldn't conceive of the future of Afghanistan on the basis of the declared US intent. And Taliban famously said at that time that the West might have the watches, but they had the time. So they just ducked, they kept low, and they waited for the drawdown to begin. And then when the drawdown began, then the resurgence of Taliban is there for all to see. What was the US military presence in Afghanistan? When I left Afghanistan in 2010, it was 99,700 or so, close to 100,000. 42 other countries, not just NATO countries, had also got their forces there, and they were another 50,000. So there were 150,000 well-armed troops in Afghanistan. And what is the strength of the Afghan army today? The paper strength is 141,000. And Mr. Haysom, in his report to the Security Council members, says that there is a huge attrition there because of the high rate of casualties. These casualties, when the American forces were going out of the country in 2014 already, were less than... Hello, how are you? Less than 10 a day. But in 2015, the level of casualties for such a small force became almost 15, 16 a day. By casualties, I mean dead or injured in a way that can't be redeployed in battle. What was the cost to the Western forces? For maintaining one soldier in Afghanistan for a year, it cost $1 million. So it was $150 billion that the West spent for 5-6 years, or let's say less than that, 4-5 years, minus the cost of munitions and minus the cost of conduct of warfare. And now it's finding it difficult to muster $4 billion to sustain the Afghan army. The Afghan army has been fighting with no protected surface mobility. No army fights without medevac, which is the soldier's moral support, that if he's injured, he can be taken to a hospital, because Afghanistan doesn't have an air force. It doesn't have artillery. It doesn't have what it takes to have a military. It cannot protect its borders, because the Taliban come into Afghanistan from across the border. They can't close the border, because the Afghan army is made with light infantry weapons, personal weapons. This is an army which has shown extraordinary courage till now, but it can crumble at any time if this sustained pressure is mounted for one more year, and we'll come to that in a minute or two when we talk about sustainability of the peace process. Then Mr. Haysom mentioned the fractious elite. The amazing thing about Afghanistan was that 2 years ago, when they had their presidential elections, the electorate voted twice in the face of threats from the Taliban to boycott elections, or else their thumbs would be cut off. A few thumbs were cut off, but not so many lives were lost, surprisingly. And the people of Afghanistan came out in large numbers and voted. But the results were decided not really by how people voted, but how the votes were counted. And by all reckoning, there was industrial scale rigging in the counting process and malpractices from both sides. So the US Secretary of State, John Kerry, played a great role in bringing about a reconciliation between the two contenders. And so Ashraf Ghani became president, and a position not accounted for in the Afghan constitution, that of the CEO, the chief executive officer, in lieu of a prime minister, that was given to Abdullah Abdullah, with a very complicated agreement, written agreement, about how the spoils of office would be divided between the two camps. As a result of which, Afghanistan doesn't have a defense minister 2 years after, or more than 2 years after the elections were held. But all said and done, this reconciliation between the two top leaders was brought about as much by US intervention as by pressure from below, because if Ashraf Ghani and Abdullah Abdullah don't work together, all hell will break loose in Afghanistan. President Karzai operated, whatever you may say about him, he had no comprehension of economics, no understanding of governance. He did very little to build institutions. It was a very personalized kind of way he managed Afghanistan. But one thing you have to grant him, that he operated a big tent policy. And he brought in all elements, and he made sure that the Loya Jirga that put together the constitution, actually, those Mr. Surya Narayana would know very well that it was an Afghan-American diplomat who actually wrote much of that paper that became the constitution and engineered the outcome of that Loya Jirga. But it was done in a way that every presidential state slate for elections has to have the two vice presidents from different ethnicities. So willy-nilly, there is a system that when Abdullah contested or Ashraf Ghani contested, Dostum, for instance, is one of the vice president, a prominent Uzbek leader, and Abdullah also had Mohakik, a prominent Hazara leader and a prominent Pashtun leader in his slate. So despite the fractious nature of Afghan politics today, I think the big tent idea has still survived. But below the surface, if the military continues to be under pressure, and if things break down in Kabul, then what's going to happen with the army? There is a frightening possibility that the soldiers would just take the next available vehicle and their personal weapons and go back to their villages to defend their homes and hearts. This will be pretty much the situation as existed during the Mujahideen rule from 1992 to 95, when the Taliban began taking over the rest of the country. And also the resistance to the Taliban rule came from the same freedom fighters in Afghanistan who the West designated later as warlords. So warlordism has returned in Afghanistan, and you have seen on television these dramatic pictures of Ata Muhammad Noor, the governor of Balkh, operating and directing his foot soldiers, who are not from the Afghan National Army, but his own militia, against Taliban groups in his area. So then Mr. Haysom said that it's very important that the international community must sustain Afghanistan. And that's true, because Afghanistan is a project which requires long-term perseverance. It requires the international community to stay there simply because 70% of their budget is met from foreign funding. And it was the same in the past and the same today. Look at the amount of money that has been spent in Afghanistan. According to the GAO reports, almost $1 trillion were spent by the US in the war effort, and some people say $108 billion in so-called civilian assistance. If you total up what the Americans spent and what the other international donors spent from the G8 countries, and then what even a poor country like India put in Afghanistan, some $2 billion, it's quite a significant amount of money. And if that money were simply, instead of bombs on Afghan homes, been thrown down from an aircraft into Afghan villages, arguably the situation in Afghanistan might be perhaps better or the same as it is today, after so much loss of life and so much loss of time and international effort. But whatever has happened has happened. Why did foreign aid not work? Because the foreign aid money was spent by different nations to support their fighting forces through a very peculiar mechanism called provincial reconstruction teams. So 75% of Canadian assistance to Afghanistan, for instance, was spent in the Kandahar region because Canadian forces were there. 75% of British funding was spent in Helmand because the British forces were there. And what do you mean by spent? By spent, you mean that that money was used to bribe local, the same warlords who are decried by political leaders in the West and by the Western media. This money was used to buy support of the community leaders so that those Western forces could operate in a more free atmosphere, free from attacks from the local communities, whether they were branded as Taliban or now as Daesh or anything else. So there is very little to show for it. And, you know, we trained each and every, we have the ITEC program in Afghanistan till today. In terms of training, we tried to build public institutions. We instituted a scheme with the UNDP in my time, because the hiatus between what international civil servants were getting, what consultants were getting, a consultant working with the banking system in Afghanistan, for instance, would be drawing a daily allowance, which would be multiples of the yearly salary of an Afghan bank worker. So we devised a scheme where Indian public servants went in as mentors to Afghan ministries and worked with Afghan public servants. We took all the people who were trainable to India to train them in computers, in accounting, and so on. We took all the people who were teaching in the Afghan universities that were denuded of talent because there were successive waves of migration out from Afghanistan. When the Russians came, the first wave of people went out of Afghanistan after Christmas Eve of 79, when the tanks came in from former Soviet Union. The second wave of migration out was when President Najibullah fell in 1992, 3 years after the former Soviet Union withdrew from Afghanistan. The third migration out of Afghanistan came when Taliban occupied the country in 1996. And so in 2001, 2002, when the universities were brought back on their feet, there were undergraduates who were teaching courses. So we gave scholarships and made sure that they got their graduate degrees in India, some got PhDs. But the manner in which the UN and international agencies operated there, there was a great sucking out from Afghan public institutions of whatever talent was there into these organizations which were supposedly to help Afghans through the PRT system. And their way of operating was doing their projects out of their laptops. There is no paper record of what they did. There is no example that is there to follow. They, whatever they had to do, they did. They packed their laptop and their suitcase and went out of the country. That's the tragedy of Afghan development. What about sustainable peace? Sustainable peace has two aspects of it. One aspect is pure security, pure military, the stabilization of Afghanistan. The other aspect is economic sustainability, because you can't run a country permanently for all times to come with foreign money. So how can Afghanistan be sustainable? As it had been sustainable in history, if it were to become a hub for regional trade, transportation, energy, and minerals, if it became what Hamid Karzai used to call the crossroads between Inner Asia, Central Asia, Iran on the one hand, and China and the Indian subcontinent on the other, what Ashraf Ghani calls the roundabout. If we don't do that, then Afghanistan will not be sustainable, and there India comes up against the conundrum of not having overland access to Afghanistan through Pakistan, and that will be a function of how India-Pakistan relationship in the future. On the peace process with the Taliban, everybody says it should be Afghan-led. But that's lip service, because we have been talking about an Afghan-led and Afghan-owned peace process since 2008. And in 2009, 2010, there were conferences in Paris, in London, which put the international imprimatur on it. We are now in 2016. When Ashraf Ghani came to power, he decided to turn his attention to Pakistan and to China. And he succeeded he made a major diplomatic gain by getting the Chinese to directly interest themselves in the affairs of Afghanistan. Because he thought, and the Chinese also thought, that their presence in Afghanistan might have a salutary effect on Pakistan. But when Ashraf Ghani went a few months after his election to Islamabad, he surprised Sartaj Aziz, because when he landed at the airport, instead of going to his hotel, he drove straight to GHQ Rawalpindi. And the Foreign Office guys who were accompanying him were taken by surprise. But he went there and had a talk with Raheel Sharif, the present army chief of Pakistan. And he later debriefed people in Kabul and told us that he did that because he knew the source of problems in Afghanistan. He asked for three things of Raheel Sharif. He said, number one, please ensure, we are now almost into winter, that in 2015 there is no spring and summer offensive launched by the Taliban. Number two, that there should be action taken against the most bloodthirsty and well-organized Taliban strike force led by the Haqqani network. And the third was that the Pakistan should make every effort, because the Quetta Shura was located, the Taliban leadership of some just under 24 top leaders of the Taliban, most of them lived in Pakistan, that they should be brought to the negotiating table. Pakistan unfortunately reneged on all three, because the Pakistan army has a huge genuine problem in dealing with this issue, despite the fact that it might hurt them in the long term. And that difficulty arises from the fact that Pakistan has been the, what you can call, incendiarist and the firefighter at the same time. There has been no situation of successful counter-terrorism or counter-insurgency in any part of the world where support, sustenance, and sanctuaries come from the contiguity. Until that goes on, you cannot control this fully. And Iftikhar Bhai just mentioned that when Ashraf Ghani went to the United States on his state visit, he visited the USIP in New York, where he, USIP in Washington, where he made this famous statement that the problem is not one between Afghanistan and the Taliban. The problem is between Afghanistan and Pakistan, that the two countries have been in a state of undeclared war against each other. and that if this were to be settled, then there could be peace and reconciliation in Afghanistan. And that is pretty much the hope that he is holding out still. But what has happened is tragic, because Afghanistan today, in the beginning of 2016, in terms of its politics on reconciliation, is standing exactly where it was standing in the beginning of 2015. But the ground from under the feet of the Afghan regime has shifted, and they are in a state of extreme fragility. And the one line message that comes out from Haysom's presentation to the Security Council is that Afghanistan is in a precarious condition. And so our best hope for Afghanistan is, if it survives at this low state of sustenance for a year or two, long enough to get Taliban to realize that they cannot force victory. In the meantime, there is going to be a political transition in Washington, D.C., whether it's a friendly changeover or a hostile changeover in terms of which party comes to power, doesn't matter. But then there might be some shift in what might happen in Afghanistan. And unlike many other trouble spots in the world, the future of Afghanistan will still be decided by, euphemism is international community, by a US-led initiative on Afghanistan. So if Afghanistan is able to sustain itself through this difficult, trying moment, and if Taliban comes to the realization that they cannot win a military victory, then there might be some hope for the peace process. Why I'm saying this is I've got very close familiarity with another peace process in South Asia. That's the peace process in Nepal. And I have got a nodding familiarity with the peace process in Tajikistan, where the present regime of Rakhmanov settled with the Islamic Renaissance Party. And it was a very short civil war there, and a long civil war of 9-10 years in Nepal, which cost 16,000 lives and 1,600 disappeared. But the first peace agreement was done in New Delhi in November 2005, when the 6 or 7 main democratic parties signed a document with the Maoists. The very next year, in November 2006, there was a comprehensive peace agreement. And then the most strange thing happened. The Maoists and the democratic parties got together after a popular agitation in April and May of 2006. And the kingship, the monarchy, got overthrown there. And this has happened in no other peace-building process anywhere in the world, that the former members of the Maoist Party, the People's Liberation Army, are now, have since been inducted into the Nepal Army. And why did that process succeed in Tajikistan and in Nepal, and why has it failed to succeed in Afghanistan? For a very simple reason, that before the peace process was properly engaged in both these countries, the Islamic Renaissance Party and the Maoist Party gave an ab initio, a priori assurance that in return for the absence of reprisals and in return for their being allowed to join the national mainstream and if possible take high offices of government, they would resile from violence, they would surrender their weapons, they would join the constitutional processes. This has not happened in the case of the Taliban. What happened in the case of the Taliban is really sad. On the 7th of July in Murree, between iftar in the evening and the sehri in the morning, there was a meeting of the first meeting between the Afghan government representatives and the Taliban, where diplomats from Pakistan, United States, and China were present. And the Security Council met after that first meeting, hopeful that a second meeting would follow the month later in August. And when they complimented the governments of Afghanistan and Pakistan for what had happened, Pakistan took credit for it and said that the entire process had been blessed by the Taliban top leadership, which is a euphemism to say that it had been blessed by Mullah Omar, who we discovered 4 or 5 days later after the statement had been dead already for the previous 27 months. So this was a huge hoax perpetrated on the peace process. And who are the leaders of the Taliban today, and what expectations can we have of them? The leader of the Taliban is a very urbane businessman, a good fighter, a tactician, who is respected, Mullah Mansoor, but who is supposed to be working closely with the Pakistan Army establishment. Who is the number two of the Taliban? The declared number two is Siraj Haqqani, head of the military wing of the Haqqani network, who, in the words of the serving chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff of the US military, Mike Mullen, in a testimony to the US Armed Services Committee on the Hill, said is a veritable arm of the ISI. He's the number two. And the number three, who is the shadow religious affairs minister of Taliban, Habetullah Akhundzada, is the religious preceptor of the Haqqani network. Now, with these gentlemen in command, I can only wish good luck to Ashraf Ghani, who is treading on really thin ice. But nothing is going to happen to him till the end of the year, because after all, this government has been put together on the basis of American support, and that support will ensure that this government will remain in power till then. And I must say, hats off to the United States, that despite the paring down of their forces to a very minimal level of 8,500-9,000 soldiers, of which only 1,000 are special operations forces, and then they have elements of the Air Force and drones, they have been able to ward off any major calamity on the ground in Afghanistan, and they have helped Afghan National Army, despite all the handicaps that I mentioned, to still keep the country together and prevent any of the 34 provincial capitals from falling into the hands of the Taliban. So I'm ending on a little bit of a somber note, but I'm not one of those who believes that the Taliban can have an easy victory. They cannot, because we are now in the year 2016. We are not going to be able to rewind the clocks back to 20 years before this period, to 1995-96. When the entire global community had turned away from Afghanistan, and only India and Iran stood with the Northern Alliance, the people who were putting up resistance to the Taliban, and the Russians were also helping, but they were helping only on the basis of what Iran and India could pay for their equipment, and the supplies were done through Tajikistan. In the north, we set up a hospital facility in Farkhor, on the northern banks of the river Oxus, where Commander Masood and Ambassador Khalili, who was in Delhi, who happened to be with Commander Masood 2 days before 9/11, was assassinated by two Al-Qaeda operatives. And this was clearly in conjunction with the attacks on New York and Washington, D.C. And they were brought to this facility in Farkhor, but Commander Masood was brought dead. So this is where we are today. But I have said all this to you only to provoke you so that we can have a good discussion afterwards.
Thank you.
Thank you.